So last class we were discussing about the spectral domain MOM, and this was the final expression we have got for the MOM. This is the B matrix, this is the I matrix and Z matrix. So let us try to see what are these B matrix, Z matrix, so that we can find out the I matrix. Z matrix has four components: XX, XY, YX, YY. So now this XX, XY, YX, YY in the superscript, and we also have in the subscript NM. So you have two notation for the Z matrix, one for the superscript and one for the subscript. Subscripts for the I and J. P and Q is, it can take any value, let's say X or Y. So you can replace this PQ by any value X and Y. And NM is the I and J, which can go from 1 to capital N and 1 to capital M. So now how do I calculate this Z matrix? It's a three double differentiation. The first double differentiation is with respect to dx and dy. It's over the testing region. So it's a region in which you are observing the field. And dx dash and dy dash is for the source region. So this is over the source region. Double differentiation is over the source region. We also have another double differentiation with respect to kx and ky, which is from the inverse Fourier transform we have performed. So this Green's function is easy to calculate in the obtain in the Fourier transform domain, spectral domain. So that's why we have done the inverse Fourier transform. We know how to find this now. So these are the basis function BPN and BQN M. So now this you multiply with this exponential minus JKX X minus this exponential JKY Y minus Y this. So now this is an exponential function. So we can separate it out, the exponential JKX X and exponential JKX X dash. Now there are two variables here, one for the source and one for the observation. The variables with the prime coordinates are for the source and unprime coordinates are for the observation. So we separate it out. We can separate the double differentiation with respect to X, dx and dy, and dx dash and dy dash. And looking at this term here, this term looks like 2D Fourier transform of this basis function. And this also looks like 2D Fourier transform of this basis function, BNP and BNQ. So the only thing is that you need to worry about the sign. So one of them is positive, one of them is negative. That's why I have put a complex conjugate here. So when I take the complex conjugate of exponential function, I'll actually get negative of it. So one is positive, one is negative. That has been taken care of with this complex conjugate here. So now what finally you are getting is an infinite double summation, double integration over dkx and dky, which is in the spectral domain. And all the terms here, Green's function is in a spectral domain, gej, pq is in a spectral domain. Spectral domain functions are denoted with a tilde hat, and here also tilde hat. Even the basis function bnq and bnp are also in the Fourier transform domain, so with a tilde here. Sign you can even also take care by just making kx and ky with a negative value here. So final expression is everything in the spectral domain. Looking at the BMP, this P can take either X or Y. M is going from 1 to capital M. This is the integration. This is a source field you are applying, and this is a testing function or basis function. Usually we take basis function and testing function same. So now when you do the integration of this, you have a double differentiation over the testing function, testing region, which over the integration over dx and dy. But we can even do the Fourier transform of this source, which is in the space domain from the spectral domain. So then we have this infinite series integration from the Fourier transform over dkx and dky. The idea is basically to bring all the integrands in the Fourier transform domain. So now you take this and this together and do the integration, what you are getting is also like a Fourier integration, Fourier transform. So finally what you have is integrand is basically multiplication of this BMP in the Fourier transform domain with the source in the Fourier transform domain. So everything is in the Fourier transform domain now. So this is also a double integration, infinite integration in the Fourier transform domain. So now this double integrations actually creates problems. So infinite integrations actually create problem. Whenever this function integrand has a singularity, there is an issue here. Even here also, let's say when this integrand here is having a singularity, when you do that infinite integration from minus infinity to plus infinity over dkx and dky, there is going to be a problem whenever you have a singular function here. So that's what we are going to discuss. First thing first, let us try to change this double infinite integration to a one single infinite integration with another definite integration. So we actually want to do a polar coordinate transformation from kx and ky. You can do polar coordinate transformation. Kx can be represented as k rho cos of alpha. Ky can be represented as k rho sine of alpha. Alpha is going from 0 to 2 pi. Now this k rho will be going from 0 to infinity. So this infinite integration, double integration, can be converted into one single infinite integration by doing this coordinate transformation, polar coordinate transformation. Let us do that first. When I do polar coordinate transformation, dkx, dky will become k rho, dk rho plus d alpha. So even this k rho also can be absorbed in the integrand, and we just do the integration over dk rho and d alpha. So now I have already told you, whenever you have a pole, there is an issue with the integration, infinite integration. Let's say there is a pole at k rho equal to k rho 0. So we'll denote the poles as k rho 0. When k rho becomes k rho 0, there is a pole. And usually it has been observed from the experience that whenever you have a dielectric substrate, this pole is actually located in between k naught and the square root of epsilon r k naught. This k rho naught location is in between k naught and the square root of epsilon r of k naught. Epsilon r is the relative permittivity for the dielectric material you are using. So let's say you have a microstrip antenna. This microstrip antenna is printed on a substrate. What is the epsilon r for that substrate? From there you can find out what is the range or value over which you need to worry about this location of the poles. So now the infinite integration you have from 0 to infinity over dk rho can be divided into three portions, 1, 2, and 3. And basically you assume that there's a very small value of delta. Delta is usually of the order of 0.001 k naught. You consider a very small value of delta, which is of the order of 0.001 k naught. And you do the first integration from 0 to k rho 0 minus delta. So the location of the pole is at k rho 0. I want to avoid the integration. I want to do a preparation for how to do integration over the interval in which k rho naught is there, where you have a singularity. So this first integration I want, which is going from 0 to k rho 0 minus delta, is not going to have any poles here. So this integration can be done as usual. You don't need to worry. You can just do integral 2, or let's say integral 1 or integral 2. Simple integration you can do here, because poles are not included in this region of integration when you go from 0 to k rho 0 minus delta. Let us consider the next interval of integration from k rho 0 minus delta to k rho 0 plus delta. So in this, definitely we have a singularity here, because k rho is equal to k rho naught, there is a singularity. So this small interval in which singularity is there, we need to take care of proper integration, how to do the singularity extraction. There would be the discussion of the next slides and so on. So let us look at this. We are doing integration from 0 to infinity. So we should actually go up to infinity, starting from 0 to k rho 0 minus delta, k rho 0 minus delta to k rho 0 plus delta, then k rho 0 plus delta to infinity, d k rho d alpha. So this infinite integration also will have a proper discussion how to go up to infinity. Is it necessary to go up to infinity? We can actually apply convergence principle and find out whether we should go up to infinity or not. So basically, the infinite integration from 0 to infinity has been converted into three integration, I1, I2, and I3. I1 can be integrated easily. I3 and I2 we need to discuss. So now this I2, in which you have a pole in the integral, that means integral is becoming infinite at one particular value, which is called k rho naught. You have to do it properly. So assume that this function here you are integrating. The integrand is basically ratio of, it has a numerator and denominator. Numerator is denoted by f function and denominator by g function. Whenever g becomes zero, it is become infinite. You have a singularity. And you also assume that pole for which this function g is going to zero is a complex number. So k rho would in that case become k rho is equal to k rho 0 minus j gamma. Assume that k rho 0 was along the real line. If your k rho in which the function is g is becoming 0 is not along the real line, then it becomes a complex number. So let us make that extension. K rho is k rho 0 minus j gamma. Now is no longer on the real line. Let us use the simple Taylor series expansion of the denominator. Denominator is a g function. We do the Taylor series expansion. So g k rho would be equal to g k rho 0 minus j gamma. This is the location of the pole. Then k rho minus k rho 0 minus j gamma. This is the interval. And g ds k rho 0 minus j gamma. So this usual Taylor series expansion at the for the k rho near k rho 0 minus j gamma. You'll have higher order terms, so, but higher order terms are not required because our interval is very small. We can just consider to the second Taylor series expansion, second term only. And you know that g function was going to 0 at k rho 0 minus j gamma, so this term will become 0. So g k rho will simply turns out to be k rho minus k rho 0 plus j gamma g ds k rho 0 minus j gamma using the Taylor series expansion. So I can do the integration of numerator by denominator, which is a f function and g function. I just replace this g function by this term here, this term here. Look at this, g ds k rho 0 minus j gamma is a constant. You can take it outside. The integration simply becomes f k rho divided by k rho minus k rho 0 plus j gamma over the interval k rho 0 minus delta, k rho 0 plus delta. And also know that we have a very small interval here, very small interval. That's why this function itself will not have much variation over this small interval. So I can just find out this function f as simply approximately equal to f k rho minus j gamma, which is the location of the pole. So even this numerator also you can take it out because it is almost constant over this small interval we are considering. So the integration simply turns out to be this. And later on, you'll see that for real root or complex root later on, if you consider it's a real root, this integration will simply become j pi f k rho 0 divided by g dash k rho 0. This function, this numerator divided by this denominator, and this whole thing will turn out to be something like j pi. How do you find that? So that's a difficult question. How do you find it? You need to have a background in the contour analysis. So let us do that. Let's make a digression now and try to do a proper understanding of what is improper integral. For example, like you have an infinite integration which is going from minus infinity to plus infinity fx dx. So when you do this integration, this is called improper integral because it's going from minus infinity to plus infinity and it has a pole at x is equal to x0. So in this range of integration from minus infinity to plus infinity, there is a pole of this integrand function. function fx at x is equal to x0. So this is an improper integral. So we have this kind of integration in our previous analysis. So let us try to understand this improper integral. Integral is done along the real axis. So now I can represent this integral as limit r tends to infinity integration from minus infinity r to plus r fx dx. And this integral can be carried out over a contour in a complex plane. Our integration, original integration, was along the real axis, which was infinite integration of fx dx, where fx is a pole at x is equal to 0. But we'll convert it into a complex integration and do the contour integration and solve this improper integral. So the improper integral we have was contour integration was from minus infinity to plus infinity. So r was going from infinity to minus infinity to plus infinity. And we have a pole at x is equal to x equal to x0 along the real line. So we can do contour integration over this semicircle. This turns out to be semicircle now. This is a real line. So any point on this semicircle here would be complex. So we'll do complex contour integration. There are two ways of this. See, basically along the real line, you have a, when you do the contour integration over the semicircle along the real line, we have a pole here at x equal to 0, x0. So there are two ways for this. Either you deform this semicircular region, you deform the semicircular region as in part B of the figure or part C of the figure. The part B of the figure, you actually excluded the pole. You consider a small semicircle here, which is called C0, and exclude these poles. In the last part, part C, what we do is, why not we include this pole by considering another semicircle C0 like this. Both the ways it works, we'll discuss it later on. Just before that, let us discuss about the Wirtinger calculus. How do you find the complex derivative of a complex function fz? When you have a function which is a complex function, see, basically this kind of analysis, I think usually most of the students learned it in second year of their undergraduate study. So complex derivative of a complex function, let us just revise it so that you might have forgotten, it's a long time now. For a function fz of complex variable, z is a complex variable, it has real part x and imaginary part y. J is the imaginary number. And z belongs to complex and xy is basically real. So if I want to find the derivative of fz with respect to z, partial derivative of fz with respect to z, I have two definitions for that. One is, when I do partial derivative of fz with respect to z, what I get is, how do I find it? This partial derivative of fz with respect to z. I simply multiply half and find out partial derivative of fz with respect to x. Partial derivative of fz with respect to x. X was the real part. Minus j times partial derivative with respect to y. Y was the imaginary part of fz. You find out dfz by dx minus j times dfz by dy, and you multiply by half, then you get partial derivative of fz with respect to z. Let's say if you want to find derivative of fz with respect to z star, what you do is you find out partial derivative of fz with respect to x plus j times partial derivative of fz with respect to y. There's a sign change here, huh? Into half, then you get the partial derivative with respect to z dash. Z dash is basically x minus jy, because z is the complex conjugate of z. Z star is the complex conjugate of z. So z is x plus jy, so z star would be x minus jy. So let us try to find out, for example, by taking simple example, the definition looks very, cumbersome. So if you actually do it for some simple examples like this, fz is equal to az, how do I find dfz by z? So there was a formula, you find dfz by dx. When you find dfz by dx, what do you get? A is x plus jy, you simply get A. This is A. When you do find dfz by dy, So a x plus jy, so it simply becomes ja. So ja into j, what do you get? Minus a. Minus a into minus, it becomes plus. So a plus a divided by 2, you get a. So partial derivative of dfz with respect to a becomes a. But had it been plus here, for dfz by dz star, then it will become minus a minus a, so you get 0 here. Similarly, you can find out fz is az star, then dfz by dz is equal to 0, dfz by dz star is equal to a. Similarly, if you have fz is equal to z into z star, when you do partial derivative of dfz with respect to z, you get z star, and partial derivative of dfz with respect to z star, you get z. So that's the definition of complex derivative of a complex function fz. And there is another function which we will be using, is basically called analytic function. What's the definition for analytic function? We'll be using only analytic functions here. A function fz is said to be analytic at a point z is equal to z naught if the derivative f dash z exists at z naught. We have defined what is derivative now. So if derivative f dash z exists at z naught and in some small region around it, so if the function fz is having a derivative f dash z at z naught and in small region surrounding it, the z naught, then you said that fz function is analytic at point z is equal to z naught. So there is another condition which is called Cauchy-Riemann condition, which is very much important here. So if fz may be written as a sum of two functions, the function fz, z is a complex number, can be written as a function of two functions. Fz can be expressed in this form, like uxy plus jvxy. X and y are the real and imaginary part of z. So if I can express fz as uxy plus jvxy, then the derivative was defined like this. The definition of derivative we have just discussed now, half times df by dx minus j df by dy. It will exist, so the condition for existence for the derivative can be found out from the Cauchy-Riemann condition. Cauchy-Riemann condition says that if your du by dx is equal to dv by dy, and du by dy is equal to minus dv by dx. In that case, Cauchy-Riemann condition is satisfied and the function will have derivative. Let's see, let's take some simple example. Fz is equal to az. Then what is dfz by dz? It was a, we have already found out. But just before finding out the derivative, let us see whether there is a derivative by applying the Cauchy-Riemann condition. So now in this case, uz would become ux plus, az will become ax plus ay. So you can find out u will become ax, b will become ay. Is that okay? So we want to write in this form u plus jby. U plus jb, where u and b are function of x and y. So this becomes ax plus jy. So it becomes u becomes ux, b becomes ay. So when you do partial derivative of u with respect to x, b with respect to y, you get a. And you do partial derivative of u with respect to y, it becomes 0. B with respect to x, it becomes 0. So the Cauchy-Riemann condition is satisfied for this particular function. So now the integration we have considered was along the real line, and we have a poles at x is equal to x0. And if function is analytic and it's continued over the upper half plane means real line is along this, upper half plane is in this portion, lower half plane in this. So imaginary part of z should be positive for that. We actually do the analytic continuation of fz in the upper half plane. So in that case, we can actually do the integration over the complex variable z. So the integration was over the contour c fz dz. So now we can write this as limit r tends to infinity minus r to plus r fx dx plus cx cs dfz dz. What was cs? Cs was the this. This was cs. This was CS, we are doing integration from minus R to plus R. So integration over this whole thing would be actually composed of this portion, which is along the real line minus r to plus r, and integration over this CS here, semicircle. So integration over the whole contour fz dz should be equal to limit r tends to infinity over the real line minus r to plus r fx dx over the semicircle CS fz dz. And assume that this CS is a semicircle of very large radius. There are two, three conditions, assumptions we have met here. First assumption is that fz should be analytic everywhere in the upper half plane, defined by imaginary part z greater than or equal to zero, except for a finite number of isolated singular points. You assume that fz is analytic in the upper half plane, except at some singular points. And second assumption is that fz should vanish strongly as 1 by z squared. Fz is actually decreasing very fast with respect to modulus of z. When modulus z tends to infinity, it will become almost zero. So fz has variation with respect to z as 1 by z squared, where z is tending to zero. So in that case, the integrand is tending to zero whenever the semicircle radius is becoming larger and larger. So two assumptions. One is that it's analytic in the upper half plane, and it's also its variation with respect to z is decreasing very fast as 1 by z squared. So in the part B of the figure, we actually deform the semicircle we have considered like this. In the part B, we actually try to exclude the singularity at x is equal to x0 by considering a semicircle C0 here. So let us consider this part B first. So in the part B, the integration over the whole circle, the semicircle fz dz, is decomposed into three parts. First part is minus r to j0 minus rho fx dx, and this is over the semicircle we have excluded the singularity region C0. So integration was from minus r to plus r, so we have divided into three parts like last time. So the integration from minus r to j naught minus rho fx dx plus over the semicircle which has excluded the poles plus j0 plus rho to r fx dx. This is from j0 minus r rho to j0 plus rho. Then the semicircle we have considered in the upper half plane cs fz dz. So the whole integration can be expressed like this now. So we have Cauchy integral formula. Cauchy integral formula says that if a function fz is analytic on a closed contour like C, we have considered, closed contour we have considered here is a C like this, then within the integral region bounded by it, then this integration over the closed contour fz by z minus z naught dz should be equal to 2 pi j residue of fz, residue of fz. So we have a pole here, z is equal to z zero, this becomes infinite. So such kind of integration over a closed contour can be simply obtained as 2 pi j residue of fz, or residue of fz will simply become fz naught. So this integration over the closed contour fz by z minus z naught dz can be expressed as 0 when z0 is exterior of the closed contour. Z0 is the pole. If pole is outside the closed contour, then this whole integration will simply become 0. If the pole is inside the closed contour, then this whole integration will simply become 2 pi j fz naught. So this is the Cauchy integral formula, and we'll be using it to find out the complex integration we have done. Okay, so here our pole is located outside the closed contour. We are considering the second case. What was the second case? Second case is this contour here. You go from minus r to this point, then you follow this, then from this point to this plus r, then this semicircle CS. So now pole here at x is equal to x0 is not included in the integration. So what do we get for the integration over this whole closed contour by Cauchy Riemann integration formula? is there, it will become zero because pole is located outside the closed contour. So this left hand side term would become zero now. This term here, this left hand side over the closed contour, because it's not enclosing any poles. So left hand side will become zero. So left hand side becomes zero now. Right hand side, we have this. In the right hand side, minus R to R, J naught minus rho, and C0, Fz, Dz plus J naught plus rho to R, we have three integration here, where limit R is tending to infinity. In the limit rho tends to infinity, this integration would simply becomes limit rho tends to zero minus infinity to plus infinity. This whole integration would become simply minus infinity to plus infinity. And fz is a function, fz function has pole at z is equal to z zero. So you can write fz as numerator by denominator. So nz by dz, n is for the numerator, d for the denominator. And denominator has a zero, at z is equal to zero, that means denominator is equal to zero, that means this function fz has a pole at z is equal to z zero. And last time we'll do the Taylor series expansion of dz near z is equal to z near z zero. We do the Taylor series expansion. Dz will become dz zero plus z minus z zero. Dz z naught, and you know that dz zero is zero because this function becomes zero at the z is equal to z zero. So this will simply become z minus z zero dz z zero. So dz can be replaced by z minus z zero dz z zero. So fz will simply become nz by z minus z zero dz z zero. So now this integration would become limit rho tends to zero nz by z minus z zero dz z zero. So dz z zero is a constant because we're finding the derivative of dz at z is equal to zero. You can take it outside this integration. Now you can find out this integration limit rho tends to zero over the semicircle C naught nz by z minus z naught dz. So over the semicircle, I can write z is equal to z zero plus rho exponential j theta. Why? So let's say this is z zero, this will be z zero minus rho, this will be z zero plus rho. This radius is rho. So z zero minus rho, z zero plus rho, radius is rho. Z zero is the location of the poles or the zero of the digit. So z zero minus rho, z zero plus rho, radius is rho. So now this equation should be able to satisfy the equation of this semicircle C zero. No? So that can be written like this. Z is equal to z zero plus rho exponential j theta. So when theta becomes zero, this will become z zero plus rho. When theta becomes pi, exponential j pi is minus one. So j zero minus rho. So this is giving me the equation of the C zero semicircle we have considered. So dz, when you do dz of this, it will become j rho exponential j theta d theta. So we want to do the integration over the contour C0 nz by z minus z0 dz. Using this substitution, this will turn out to be nz0 plus rho exponential j phi divided by rho exponential j phi j rho exponential j phi d theta. Z minus z0 will become, z minus z0 will become rho exponential j theta, and dz will become j rho exponential j theta d theta. Nz will become nz0 plus rho exponential j theta. So this again, you can take it outside because this is almost like nz0. And this rho exponential j theta and rho exponential j theta would cancel out. You have a j, you can take it outside. So finally what you have is a very simple integration, pi to 0 d theta. So pi to 0 d theta will become minus pi. So the final integration turns out to be j pi and z naught divided by d dash z naught. We can also consider the second case where you actually include the poles at z is equal to x0. So this is the figure C. Let's look at the figure C. You consider a contour like this. From here to here, you actually consider C0, which is actually including the pole at x is equal to x0, then continue with this contour in the semicircle CS. So let's consider this second case where you include the poles also. In the second case, figure C, you actually include the poles by considering a semicircle C0. So now, since you included the poles, the integration over the closed contour C, fz dz, will actually include a pole, so it will not no longer be 0, it will be equal to 2 pi residue of fz. Residue of fz will be fz 0. So 2 pi f0 is the integration over the closed contour because we have included a pole. Right hand side still remains the same, limit r tends to infinity minus r to z0 minus rho, which doesn't have any pole. Then this C0 semicircle will have a pole, and this integration, line integration z0 to rho plus rho to r, will not have any poles. Then this semicircle in the upper half plane, Cs, fz dz. And fz is basically nz by z minus z0 d dash z0 by using the Taylor series expansion of the denominator of fz. Numerator of fz is nz, denominator of fz is dz. And residue of fz would become simply nz0 by d dash z0. So left hand side we got it. What is fz0? Fz0 is nz0 by d dash z0. By using the Cauchy-Riemann integration formula, we just find out the zeros of nz. Zeros of nz is nz0 divided by this function here, d dash z0. So this term will become 2 pi nz0 divided by d dash z0. Left hand side is like this. Now the right hand side is like this. We have actually neglected this term here because Cs was a very large semicircle in the upper half plane, and this function fz was tending to zero very fast whenever the radius of the Cs was tending to infinity. Because of that, when r tends to infinity, this term here actually is negligible. So that was one of the assumptions we made. Fz is decreasing very fast as 1 by z square. When r is tending to infinity, this will turn out to be zero. So this term can be neglected. So we just have three terms here. Minus r to z naught minus rho, then over the semicircle c naught z0 plus rho 2 r, these three terms here. So that should be actually equal to minus r to r fx dx plus limit r tends to infinity c0 fz dz. Let us look at the second term here. The second term actually is for limit rho tends to 0 and z. What is fz nz by z minus z0 d dash z0. So limit rho tends to infinity, you take this term outside, d dash z0 integration over nz by z minus z0 dz. This is actually integration over the semicircle c0. This would be very similar to what we have done last time. So you, the circle of the semicircle, the equation for a semicircle is z is equal to z0 rho plus rho exponential j theta. Whenever theta becomes 0, it becomes z0 plus rho. When theta becomes pi, it becomes z0 minus rho. That is actually the equation of the semicircle of radius rho. Dz will become j rho exponential j theta d theta. Substitute that in the previous equation where you have nz by z minus z0. Z minus z0 will become z minus z0 will become rho exponential j theta. This is what we have here. Dz will become j rho exponential j theta d theta. And the numerator is what? Nz0 plus rho e theta. So now, finally, what you have is this two cancels out. This actually, when rho is tending to 0, this term is tending to 0, and z0 plus rho tending to 0 will become simply nz0. You can take it outside. Simply the integration is from pi to 2 pi d theta. Because you see, So here, when you start from here, what is the value of theta? Theta is pi and theta here is zero. But here, when you start from here to here, the value of theta is pi and 2 pi here. So that is the limit of integration. One is from pi to zero, another is pi to zero. This integration is from pi to zero for the second case when you have excluded the poles. But in the third case, when you included the poles, the limit of integration is from pi to 2 pi because of the orientation of the semicircle is different now. So finally, minus r to r fx dx will simply become pi j and z0 divided by theta z0. And if we have real root, then the equation simply reduced to this was z0 will have only k rho naught. So in that case, integration over k rho 0 minus delta to k rho 0 plus delta f by g d k rho will simply become j pi f k rho 0 by g dash k rho 0. Okay, so that's what we have actually got at the beginning, and I have spent a lot of time how do we get this equation here. And I3 was also infinite integration. It was starting from k rho 0 plus delta to infinity, but you don't need to do this infinite integration. Infinite integration is going to take a lot of time. You can truncate it around 200 k naught or 300 k naught and check. Let's say you first do the integration from k rho 0 plus delta to 200 k naught, then 201 k naught, 202 k naught. Is there any change in the integration? No? You do a convergence analysis. If it is convergent, then you stop there. So you don't need to do integration up to infinity. Okay, that's all for this.